In this video, we will review the gross anatomy of the heart. The heart's primary function is to circulate blood around the body, and the cardiac structure enables it to fulfill this function. This whole process of coordinated cardiac contraction is mediated by the conduction system of the heart. Looking at the heart within the thoracic cavity, note the intercostal spaces as shown here. When the heart beats, the apex is palpable along the mid-clavicular line at the fifth intercostal space. When looking at the heart, firstly it is important to note the different surfaces. Inferiorly is the diaphragmatic surface, as it is in contact with the diaphragm. Laterally is the left pulmonary surface, which is in contact with the left lung. Posteriorly is the base of the heart. This is the right pulmonary surface. And lastly, the anterior surface of the heart. Looking at the anterior and posterior views of the heart, note the following structures. This area here is formed by the right atrium, this the right ventricle, here the left atrium, and this area here is largely formed by the left ventricle. This is the superior and inferior vena cava, which carry systemic deoxygenated blood to the right atrium. This blood then moves into the right ventricle to be sent to the lungs via the pulmonary trunk, then to the left and right pulmonary arteries to the lungs. Oxygenated blood from the lungs then enters the left atrium via the pulmonary veins, and blood moves to the left ventricle and enters the systemic circulation via the aorta. Note here the right auricle, which overlies the right atrium, and the left auricle over the left atrium. An interior look will reveal that the heart has four chambers: the right atrium, right ventricle, left atrium, and left ventricle. The atria and ventricles are separated by valves: the tricuspid valve on the right and mitral valve, a bicuspid valve, on the left. And separating the chambers is a septum. In the right atrium, you'll observe the openings for the superior and inferior vena cava and the fossa ovalis, which is where the foramen ovale once was and closed after birth. The atrium wall is lined by pectinate muscle, which has a tooth comb appearance due to horizontal muscle ridges. Separating the right atrium and ventricle is the tricuspid valve, which has three cusps. These cusps are attached to papillary muscles via the chordae tendineae. The papillary muscles serve to ensure the valves remain closed during systole to prevent backflow of blood into the atria during ventricular contraction. During systole, blood from the right ventricle moves into the lungs via pulmonary trunk. In the left atrium, there are openings for the pulmonary veins. Separating the atrium and ventricle is the mitral valve, which is a bicuspid valve. In this view, one can appreciate the semilunar valves of the pulmonary and aortic valves. Also attached between the pulmonary trunk and aorta is the ligamentum arteriosum, which is a remnant of the ductus arteriosus in a fetus. In the ventricles, note the irregular muscle ridges of the ventricles, known as the trabeculae carniae. We will now provide a simplified overview of the coronary circulation. Note that the left and right coronary arteries come from the base of the aorta. Here is the left coronary artery, which runs along the coronary sulcus. The branches of the left coronary artery includes the left circumflex artery, which supplies the lateral wall of the heart, and the left anterior descending artery, which supplies the anteroseptal wall of the heart. It has septal and diagonal branches. The left circumflex extends posteriorly and supplies the posterolateral aspect of the heart. The right coronary artery supplies the inferior wall. It also forms the right marginal artery. The right coronary artery can also extend posteriorly to form the posterior descending artery, which supplies the posterior wall. This is a great segue to the topic of cardiac dominance. Cardiac dominance refers to which artery dominates in supplying the posterior wall of the heart, and that is largely determined by which artery forms the posterior descending artery. It can either be left, right, or codominant. Estimates show that most of the population is right heart dominant. Consider the clinical relevance of this. If the right coronary artery is completely occluded, this will cause an inferior infarct. And one must consider that in the context of a proximal occlusion in a patient who is right dominant, there may be involvement of the posterior wall. So in this case, there is an inferior infarct with posterior extension. This is not the case if the patient is left heart dominant, as the posterior wall is being supplied by the left coronary artery. And the same is likely true in the case of codominance, where there is collateral blood supply from the left coronary artery. If the left circumflex artery is occluded, this causes a lateral infarct. If a branch of the left anterior descending artery is completely occluded, there will be a septal infarct. If there is proximal occlusion of the left anterior descending artery, there will be an anteroseptal infarct.